Hi everyone, welcome back. So in today's video, we'll be discussing everything about chassis frames. So we'll start with the different forces acting on the chassis frames, then the materials used in order to manufacture the chassis frames, and then we'll turn toward different types of these frames. So in previous lecture, we have discussed if this is a superstructure which can be called as body of a vehicle, then this body of a vehicle is placed on chassis frame. So there are several designs or different types of chassis frames, and those we are about to discuss in this video. So this I am considering as a simple form of chassis frame, and which can be called as ladder type of chassis frame. So in this chassis frame, we'll be having different members, maybe longitudinal members, maybe transverse members. We'll may find some cross mounted members. So this varies according to this designs of these frames. So this can be called a chassis frame, and chassis is completely different, but usually we call these chassis frames as chassis. But chassis, we have in last lecture also we have discussed many components like steering system, suspension system, wheels and tires. When we mount on the chassis frame, then the complete assembly can be called as chassis. So now we'll discuss different forces or loads acting on this chassis frame, and then only the as an engineer, when you'll design any chassis frame, you have to consider all these forces and loads, and you'll be able to design a perfect chassis frame. So the first load is short duration loads. So whenever the vehicle is moving on the rough surface, the vehicle may be coming across a broken patch or broken patches. Due to these broken patches, the vehicle will experience the reverse reactions, and this reaction is nothing but short duration loads. This reaction will be transferred to this chassis frame, so the frame has to sustain that load. Then momentary duration loads. So when the vehicle is taking a turn, or we can say at the time of cornering, obviously we know that the side forces, if the vehicle is taking a left turn, the side force will act on the vehicle. So vehicle need to be, or this force is also transferred through this body. This is transferred on this chassis frame. So frame has to sustain that load also. Then impact load. When the vehicle is coming across an accident, then obviously maybe front accident, rear accident or side accident, then the vehicle and hence the chassis frame will be subjected to a very high impact, and that impact the chassis frame has to sustain. See, up to certain points only the chassis frame is designed to take this impact loads, but beyond the limit obviously this frame will also fail. And the next is inertia loads. So inertia loads is because of the vehicle weight itself. So when the driver applies sudden brakes, we know that when we apply sudden brakes, the vehicle complete weight will be shifted on the front part of the chassis. If this is a front side, the complete vehicle weight will be shifted to the front. This is at the time of braking. So this weight need to be taken care by this front end of this chassis frame. And the second condition is acceleration. When the driver presses acceleration pedal suddenly, then what will happen? The front end will be shifted, or the vehicle weight, complete vehicle weight will be shifted at the rear side. So this end will experience a heavy load, and that load has to be sustained by the chassis frame. So these are the braking and accelerations. Braking and accelerations are inertia loads. And then static loads. So static loads are because of this weight of the vehicle or weights of the chassis components. Chassis components. We know that we have discussed in last lecture, maybe steering system, suspension system, wheels and tires, transmission system, engine, all are the parts of chassis. So they are having their own weight, and that weight is also placed on this chassis frame. So the chassis frame has to sustain those weights. Those can be called as static loads, and last is overload. At the time of designing chassis frame, as an engineer, we need to take care of the overloads. Means if I have designed a chassis which will sustain 2000 kg weight, I have designed a chassis to sustain 2000 kg weight, and this is the demand of application. But in sudden case or in any case, if the weight increases to 2500, then on the safer side, you have to consider factor of safety, and you have to design by considering this parameter. The vehicle may be overloaded. We know that when we design a two-wheeler is basically designed to sustain a load of two passengers, but still we may take three passengers or even four passengers. In that case, we can say it is an overload, but that vehicle do not converts into failure. It sustain that load also. So factor of safety we have to consider while designing the load, or we have to consider the overload parameter, so that even though up to certain extent if the vehicle is overloaded, this chassis frame will not fail. And now we'll turn toward the second part, which is materials used to manufacture these chassis. So we'll broadly discuss important materials. When chassis frames are invented, the first material used was steel. So we should know, as far as chassis, the application of chassis frame is concerned, we should know some important properties of this material, so that we can classify and decide the betterment of the material for this chassis frame. So the first important property is yield strength. Then second, we can consider ultimate tensile strength, then hardness of that material. Then for vehicle, we have to consider the weight of that material, and then cost. So we'll discuss broader materials used for chassis frames, and we'll discuss with respect to these five important properties. So steel, as far as steel is concerned, its yield strength is less if you compare this material with its competitor materials for the manufacturing of chassis frame. That material is called as aluminium. Always steel properties or steel frames are compared with the aluminium frames. Yield strength is less as compared to aluminium. Ultimate tensile strength is also less. Hardness is more. We know that steel is 2.5 times denser than the aluminium. So the hardness of the steel material is more. Weight is more, and then cost is less. So overall properties, if you look for, then we'll find the aluminium predicts better properties for this chassis frame application. So nowadays in many vehicles, even aluminium chassis frames are used. But the only thing is, or only disadvantage is, the cost of aluminium is more as compared to the steel material. And the third material which is used nowadays is carbon fiber. Carbon fiber predicts excellent properties. Whatever properties we have displayed here, it predicts excellent properties. But the only thing is, the cost of carbon fiber is very high. You can say per kg, or you can say if the steel material costs me around 1000 rupees, then aluminium material may cost me around 3000 rupees. However, if you compare this costing with the carbon fiber, then you will find that to purchase the same material, I need to invest around 1 lakh rupees. So it is around 100 times more if you compare the cost of this carbon fiber with the steel. But it predicts better yield strength, ultimate tensile strength, hardness, and even weight. See, weight of this carbon fiber is very less. Obviously, we know that if the vehicle weight is reduced, ultimately what will happen, the power output will improve, and because less power is required to propel the vehicle weight and fuel economy is also reduced. So this weight of the chassis frame is directly affects the power output. And carbon fiber, see, for example, if chassis weight is around 1000 kg, chassis frame which is made up of steel, then we'll find that the weight of this aluminium will be around 700 kg, and if we made up this chassis frame with the help of carbon fiber, then the weight will be around 250 kg itself. So weight is also reduced to the greater extent, and definitely the reason this material is nowadays, this material is only employed to manufacture sports cars. Some fibers of this carbon fibers are used in some sports two wheelers also, sports bikes also. So now let's move towards different types of these chassis frames. There are basically three important types of chassis frames are there: conventional, integral type of chassis frame, and semi-integral type of chassis frame. So we'll discuss one by one. In conventional chassis frame, or the conventional chassis frame can be again classified as channel section, we can call it a channel section. Then the second type is tubular section, and the third is box section. So this is a conventional chassis. Nowadays we mostly use integral type of chassis frame or semi-integral type of chassis frame. So in channel section, basically the chassis members are made up with the channel section, or in this way the channel section is used. This is a channel section which is used to manufacture the members of this chassis frame. So we have seen the longitudinal members, transverse members, maybe cross members. So these members are nothing but channel members, and the if you are using this channel section, that will find that a better bending resistance. So if the chassis frame is subjected due to several road conditions or several other condition, if the chassis frame is subjected to a bending in this way, then channel section is to be used in those applications or where the vehicle is running, and in that case we will be getting a better bending resistance. The second option that as an engineer I am having while designing the chassis frame is to go with the tubular chassis. So tubular chassis, we may see a cross section in this way. So this is a tubular chassis. So the main important advantage of this tubular chassis is it provides better torsional strength. Means we know that due to the road rough conditions, this is a tubular member of this chassis, this chassis frame will be subjected, or maybe will be subjected to the torsional forces in this way. Maybe due to the road roughness conditions, vehicle will be subjected in this way, or the vehicle may be moving in this way. So in those running condition, what will happen, this frame's members will be subjected to the twisting. See, this is a longitudinal frame, but still it is trying to rotate. This is not a rotational component, so this is a twisting moment. So the chassis frame, if it is used, or the members of this frames or tubular members are used, then definitely those will be having torsional strength. So in case of twisting moments also, these members are having ability to accept this twisting moments or twisting forces. And then third is box section. Box section is the combination of the channel section and tubular section. So we can say in this way we can use box section. So if the channel, the chassis frames members are used or is manufactured with the box section, then we'll be having bending resistance or bending strength as well as torsional strength. So this is better choice to go for this box section while designing a vehicle chassis frame. So these are the conventional chassis frames type. Now we'll move toward this integral, integral and semi-integral. Nowadays, almost all the vehicles running on the road are employing these two types, integral and semi-integral. So integral type of chassis can be called as frameless construction. So if there is a no frame, it can be called as integral type of chassis. Means this, we have discussed, this is superstructure or body of a vehicle, this is chassis frame. So we know that in this case the frame is separate and the body is separate. But what if this frame is not made up separately, if it is combined with the body itself, except several body panels, but almost all the body is built up as a single component. In that case, it can be called as integral type of structure. And nowadays, almost all the cars you will find made up of this integral or frameless construction. And then semi-integral. So in that case, we can combine, or in some designs, I can combine this part or I can attach this part as a single component with the body. However, I will join or I will use this member separately, maybe to mount the engines. So these parts or these members are made up separately as compared to the remaining members of the chassis frame. So in that case, we can say it is semi-integral. Means half part of the chassis frame is attached or is in integral with the body. However, half part is separated. So in that case, we can say semi-integral. So now let's go to the screen and we'll discuss or we'll get better understanding about these different types of chassis frames, their advantages, disadvantages, etc. So this is the simplest type of chassis frame where we use separate frame, and this can be called as conventional frame type of chassis. We have discussed here, there are basically three types: channel section, tubular section and box section. So now we'll turn toward this integral frame or frameless structure. This structure is basically employed nowadays almost by all the cars. You can observe this structure. So this overall represents, or this frameless structure represents overall shape of a car. And we eliminate the need of using long frame. There is no frame here. And as a result of it, this assembly or this frame becomes cheaper. See, there are two parameters that you have to consider. When we go for manufacturing separate frame and these body members, then definitely it will cost you a very high as compared to this structure. So this structure becomes cheaper. But at the time of accident, if the accident occurred, then what will happen? It is little bit difficult to replace a specific part. For example, if the front impact has occurred, obviously what will happen? These pulses, vibrations will be transferred to a complete body. And as a result, you may need to replace a complete integral chassis, and which will cost you very high. So two parameters are there. First, it is cheaper as compared to manufacturing separately, but at the time of accident, you may need to, if it is damaged, you may need to replace a complete structure. And the only and one more disadvantage, it's repairing it difficult. As we talked about, we cannot repair or cannot replace a single part or specific part. That is the only disadvantage. So now we'll turn towards semi-integral type. This is a combination of conventional and integral type. As you can see here, you can just observe this. See, this frame members are made separately. Those I've indicated with this color, blue color. These members are made separately or as attached to this chassis frame. So see, you have to just observe this. So this is an integral form of chassis. However, this front portion is made separately with separate components, and which is used to take the load of engine only. So if
in case of accident, if this part, front part is damaged, then obviously we'll be able to replace the first parts only. And that is the advantage, most important advantage of this semi-integral type of chassis. So few parts will be separated from this integral part. So it has one advantage on the over vehicle at the time of accident, and you'll find it's used in even many cars, maybe in Fiat cars, some of the European and American cars, you will find the use of this semi-integral type of frame. And now we'll discuss few important types of chassis frames. Those are nowadays quite popular or mostly employed. The first type is ladder frame. So this is the simplest type of form, and you'll find this type of chassis frame almost in many heavy vehicles. The construction is very simple, and these types of chassis are especially made up of the steel material, as they have to sustain a heavy weight, or maybe they have to tow a heavy vehicles. You'll simple find some longitudinal members like this, some transverse members. In some ladder type chassis, you'll find some cross members. So why it is named as ladder? Because its construction is quite looks like a ladder type. And the most important advantage of this type of chassis frame is good beam resistance, or bending resistance is better in this chassis frame. However, there is a poor resistance to torsion. See, torsion or twisting moment is especially very severe when the speed of vehicle is very high. But in case of heavy vehicles, the vehicles are mostly subjected to the bending. So good bending resistance should be there, and this is employed in heavy vehicles. So while designing these types of chassis, there are basically two important parameters: front overhang. So in order to balance the all the weights of the vehicle, we have to design these sections. Front overhang, the part which is in front of the axles can be called as front overhang, and on the back side it is called as rear overhang. Tubular space frame. This is again quite famous in case of some sports cars also, tubular, because it is having an excellent resistance to torsion. So simple, we have to use some tubes or tubular members. Those have been welded at the sections, as you can see here. May positions in different directions to provide mechanical strength against force from anywhere, and these tubes are welded and forms a very complex structure. The only thing is the structure is little bit, it becomes complex if you compare it with our conventional ladder type of chassis. But obviously the advantage of this tubular type of chassis, it is very strong in any direction. Likewise, so as you can see here, likewise the members have been welded, so even the stress is coming in this direction, in this direction, in this direction, from whatever direction the stress is coming, this tubular chassis is capable of handle this stress. So it is very strong in any direction compared with ladder type chassis and monocoque chassis of the same weight. Disadvantage, we talked about, very complex, costly and time consuming to build. Monocoque. So this is the most important type of chassis frame which is used around by 99% cars on this planet. So almost all the cars, 99% means almost all the cars are manufactured with the help of this monocoque type of chassis. Here also you will find that mostly a spot welding is used in order to join several pieces. As you can see here, this is a metal monocoque, whereas in sports cars you will find a carbon, or high-end cars you will find carbon fiber monocoque chassis. And this is basically a one-piece structure. See, monocoque chassis is integral type of chassis, one-piece structure which defines overall shape of the car. You can see this defines overall shape. However, in case of this ladder frame or tubular frame, those are only a stress members. Ladder and tubular backbone provides only stress members. That is the difference. So these types of chassis can be called as monocoque type of chassis. So disadvantage, it has very complex design. Obviously this is the only disadvantage, and impossible for small volume production. So for small volume production, the cost of this monocoque chassis is not affordable, so we cannot go for small volume production. Advantages, there are several advantages if you compare it with these disadvantages, and the reason these chassis frames are used widely nowadays. Space efficiency, the whole structure is actually on outer shell, so we'll get to make use of a space. Overall space efficiency is better. Monocoque chassis benefits crash reproduction. This is because it uses a lot of metal, and then cheap for mass production, right? It is impossible for small production, but for mass production it is affordable. The cost is affordable. These types of car, you will find that those have used this monocoque type of chassis. Aluminium monocoque. See, steel monocoque is a little bit common, but nowadays we are turning towards the aluminium monocoque. This is because of the weight of the vehicle. If you are using steel material to manufacture this monocoque, then definitely the weight is going to be very high. And nowadays you will find in high-end cars like Audi 8 model is the first mass production car featuring aluminium space frame. To replace conventional steel monocoque due to the lightness. So Audi 8 is the first manufactured car which has used aluminium space frame. This Audi 8's ASF is 40% lighter. It 40% stiffer. See, it is the weight is 40% less, but still the stiffness is 40% more. And the reason why aluminium monocoque has nowadays widely employed, the cost is only the parameter that need to be considered. And the reason it is not possible to use aluminium monocoque in affordable cars or mid-range cars. Advantages, obviously lighter than steel monocoque, as space efficient as it, and still expensive for mass production. Carbon fiber monocoque is only employed for high-end cars like sports cars, racing cars, etc. This is because of these parameters. Its rigidity to weight ratio is excellent. Even though weight is very less, however the rigidity is excellent, and the reason few fibers of carbon fiber material is used for monocoques in some mid-range cars, but however it obviously increases the cost, considerable cost rather. See, road cars featuring carbon fiber body panels such as Ferrari 288 GTO and Porsche 959 has used carbon fibers body panels, and there are several cars those have used. Kevlar, which was developed by DuPont, offers the highest rigidity to weight ratio. Now we'll discuss different models, and those are using carbon fiber materials for body and for chassis. See, Ferrari, Porsche, Ferrari, McLaren, Ferrari, Lamborghini, these are uses some body panels, body fiber panels, chassis, steel tubular space frame. See this, for example, Ferrari 288, it uses carbon fiber body panels only and steel tubular space frame. Then McLaren F1, carbon fiber panels, which is developed in 1993 along with carbon fiber monocoque, and due to this the cost of McLaren F1 was very high at that time. And now we'll just compare the ladder type monocoque and ladder type chassis frame and monocoque. See, we'll make this comparison. What is the difference when this type of chassis frame is preferred and when this monocoque type of chassis frames are preferred? So performance, design and materials. So performance, so you have to consider weight. The monocoque is lighter in design, we have discussed. If it is a lighter in design, we know that we'll find better power output, better fuel efficiency. Second, monocoque chassis has torsional stiffness, better torsional stiffness as if we compared with ladder type of chassis. And then there is one advantage with the ladder type of chassis, it is heavy in nature. Obviously the weight is increases, this is a disadvantage. However, from second sense, ladder chassis, due to this heavy nature, it becomes tough, and this is required, and it is much better than monocoque for carrying heavy loads and towing heavier objects. So as we talked about, in heavy vehicles mostly the ladder type of chassis is used as it is offering a good bending resistance. Now design, a unibody body shell is difficult to design. We know that monocoque chassis is little bit difficult to design or build or modify when compared to the body on frame or when compared to this ladder type of chassis. But nowadays if you are using this CAD, makes this platform easier to design this monocoque type of chassis frame. For body on frame vehicles, it is easy to build another body even from another body style and place it on ladder chassis. So it is very easy to build this ladder type of chassis, and we can use even different bodies to place on the same chassis. So this is possible, which is not possible with the help of this monocoque type of chassis. We can only use monocoque type of chassis to a single model. And materials, these body shells monocoque can be made from a variety of materials, steel and steel alloys, aluminium, aluminium alloys and carbon fiber or combination of this material, whereas ladder type of chassis are usually built from steel only.
So friends, I hope you like this information and video. If you do have any questions regarding the chassis frames, their types, functions, materials, etc., please do write me in the comment box. I'll try to answer all these questions. So we'll see in my next video. Bye bye.